So now we're going to talk about the other part of box 8.3, the left-hand part, which actually is about monetary evaluation methods. The book calls it demand curve approaches to valuation. What demand curve approaches really means is that we're going to observe people spending money on something that's related to the environmental good, and either spending money or saying that they'll spend money, claiming that they would spend money, and using that spending data, either real spending data or hypothetical spending data, in order to really find a value for the environmental amenity that is under discussion. So the video that I just ended was talking about the right hand part of box 8.3, which I said was not really about valuation, but this video, which is on the left hand side of box 8.3, is about valuation. And this topic is very long. We certainly can't cover it in one video. We probably it's going to take us multiple videos to go through valuation methods. I first want to make a distinction between the two basic types of valuation methods: expressed preference and revealed preference. The express preference method is you don't observe people actually spending money in a marketplace. Instead, you do a survey and you ask them hypothetical questions about how much money they would spend. So there's only one express preference method, and it's called contingent valuation. And as I wrote here, contingent valuation involves asking hypothetical questions on a survey of the type, how much would you be willing to pay to clean up the air in Salt Lake City? Or how much money would you be willing to accept in compensation for not cleaning up the air in Salt Lake City? In contrast to the contingent valuation, which is the express preference method, we have two revealed preference methods. The revealed preference methods come from data based on observed behavior. So this is behavior in the real world. There are two revealed preference methods. One is called the travel cost method, and the other is called the hedonic pricing method, or hedonic pricing. Just a brief introduction. The travel cost method values an environmental amenity like a national park by asking how much money do we observe people actually paying in order to visit the national park, and then making a rationality assumption that they wouldn't be paying the amount of money that they are paying unless they value the park at least that much. We'll get into details in a moment, but that's just a brief survey of the travel cost method. Hedonic pricing is actually a little hard to describe as just a brief survey, but if you think about house prices, suppose you had houses that were physically identical on lots that were physically identical in locations that are, well, of course the locations can't be identical, but very similar locations. But one of them, let's say, had a really great view and the other didn't have a great view. Then you could, presumably the one that had a great view would sell for more money than the one that had no view. And economists could say that the difference in price between the one that had a good view and the one that didn't have a good view is the value that people were putting on the good view. And so you could see, because of the way that these two houses sold for different prices in the marketplace, the value that people put on a nice view. So that's a flavor for what the hedonic pricing method does. Just like the travel cost method, the hedonic pricing method uses the prices that people are actually paying for commodities in order to infer what the value that they're placing on the environmental amenity is. So now what I'd like to do is get into the details of the travel cost method, and that is what will occupy us for the rest of this video. A description first. Typically, the travel cost method is done by sending people to do surveys of, let's say, visitors to a national park. And the survey is attempting to find out how much money the visitor to the national park had to pay. So, of course, they had to pay the national park entrance fee, unless they had some kind of discount for that. But that's usually a very small part of what visitors had to pay. Suppose a survey taker encounters a visitor to Yellowstone National Park who comes from Germany or from Japan. So they had to pay a lot of money for the airfare to get to Yellowstone National Park, and you would also include the airfare going back to their home country. There'd be lodging expenses, ground transportation expenses, and so forth. And you'd add those all up, and you'd say that, well, the visitor should value Yellowstone National Park at least as much as the amount of money that it costs the visitor to pay to get there. So the travel cost method doesn't tell you exactly how a visitor values the park, but the travel cost method puts a lower bound on the visitation by the visitor of the park. So that's the description of it. Well, how about the problems with the travel cost method? And what we'll see in this chapter is that your authors are really good about spending time discussing problems with each one of these valuation methods. So problem number one, time costs. The first is wages. If you ask, suppose you interview a heart surgeon from Salt Lake City who's at Yellowstone National Park. One of the most important travel costs to him or her is not the gasoline and the lodging expenses of driving from Salt Lake City to Yellowstone National Park to visit. One of the biggest costs is the opportunity cost, the lost wages, because instead of doing heart surgery back in Salt Lake City and earning they are instead visiting Yellowstone National Park and not earning anything at all. And remember the idea of opportunity cost? If you have two mutually exclusive choices, performing heart surgery in Salt Lake City or visiting Yellowstone National Park on a particular day, then the opportunity cost of one is the value of the other. So if on a particular, let's say Friday, the heart surgeon has an option to either perform heart surgery in Salt Lake City or to go to Yellowstone National Park, if the heart surgeon decides to go to Yellowstone National Park, then the opportunity cost of going to Yellowstone National Park is the wages that he or she could have earned doing heart surgery in Salt Lake City. So those wages, that opportunity cost, ought to be added to the travel cost. But it's very hard to get data on that. If you ask people, how much would you be earning at your regular job if you decided to work at your regular job instead of taking a vacation and coming here? People are often reluctant to answer that question. And so it's hard to get data on wages, on these opportunity costs. Even harder to get data on are non-pecuniary costs and benefits of travel. So let's assume that you have you interview two visitors from Yellowstone National Park, and both of them live in, their hometown is Tokyo, Japan. So they both came from Tokyo to visit Yellowstone National Park. They paid the same airfare, they had the same itinerary, went to the same hotels. So you might say that, suppose that call them person A and person B, and suppose both of them spent $5,000 in explicit travel costs to get to Yellowstone National Park. And suppose both of them are retired, so they don't have to worry about the wages part. But suppose that person A is really scared of flying. They had to fly in order to come to America to visit Yellowstone. But this was very difficult for them to do psychologically. It put them under a lot of stress. And so it was a psychological cost added to the monetary cost of the trip. So person A is fearful of flying. Suppose that person B loves to fly. Person B flies whenever they have an opportunity, just for the fun of it. They don't really care much about the destination. So my claim is that even though both of these might have exactly the same $5,000 explicit costs for visiting Yellowstone, their true costs are quite different. A's true travel cost to visit Yellowstone National Park is very high. So a high true travel cost. And B has a low true travel cost. You know, yes, person B spent $5,000 to travel to Yellowstone National Park, but maybe he doesn't really care about Yellowstone National Park. It was just an opportunity to get on an airplane. Maybe he would have been just as happy to spend $5,000 to visit Las Vegas or St. George, Utah, or Salt Lake City, Utah. Maybe it was the flying that this person really wanted to enjoy, not so much the destination. If, as is almost certainly the case, you as an economist doing a survey can only get data about this, you have no idea, there's no way for you to get data on this, let alone to quantify in dollar terms the fear of flying of person A and how much person B loves to fly. Then you as an economist, you only see the $5,000 figure, and you're going to conclude incorrectly that person A and person B value Yellowstone equally. Whereas actually they don't. Actually their true travel costs are quite different. And so actually it's person A that values Yellowstone a lot more than person B, because person A had to incur a lot more costs, monetary and psychological costs, than person B did in order to visit Yellowstone. Okay, I think I'll stop the video here. The next video will begin here with problem number 2 of the travel cost method.